The US EPA recently announced interim drinking water health advisory levels for the PFAS compounds, PFOA and PFOS, that are over 1,000 times lower than previous levels. To understand why, I reached out to Heather Lanza, who's an expert in PFAS health risk. She explained to me the reason for these changes, what could be coming next from EPA, and how water providers should react. Check it out.
So there's a variety of different health effects that might be associated with PFAS exposure, right? And of course, the magnitude of that exposure is going to result in different potential health effects. So for example, there has been some suggestive evidence of certain cancers, testicular cancer being among them. But this seems to be more likely to occur in occupationally exposed individuals, individuals that are receiving a lot more PFAS exposure than just kind of the general populace at large. There are also some liver-related effects and some growth-related effects as well. But the immunotoxic effects appear to be the most sensitive. And so therefore, if we can protect against exposures that may cause this immunosuppression, we can also theoretically be protective of all of these other health effects as well. And so this significant decline in the selected reference dose by US EPA based upon those immunotoxic endpoints is really what's driving the significant decline in the health advisory levels. And there's actually a couple of reasons for why we see the significant reduction in the health advisory levels. The first and most significant is that change to the reference doses. So EPA has released draft reference dose values for PFAS and PFOA, and that's why we see the health advisory levels for these two compounds as interim, right? At the time of this recording, they have not been finalized. And a reference dose ultimately is the allowable amount of chemical an individual can be exposed to every day over the course of a lifetime without appreciable health risks. I think that it's important to remember that the health advisory levels are very similar to the MCLG, which is the maximum contaminant level goal. This is a health-based value. It's not enforceable. And PFAS would not be the first chemicals for which the MCLG is zero, meaning that no exposure is the best exposure. But we can use these MCLGs, these health-based guidance values, in concert with economic considerations and treatment technologies. And that's how we derive our maximum contaminant level, or our MCL.
And EPA is expected to issue those maximum contaminant levels, MCLs, imminently, right? What are you hearing about the timing of that regulation?
Yeah, absolutely. So per the US EPA strategic roadmap, there will be national drinking water regulations, MCLs derived for both PFAS and PFOA. The intent is to see those in draft form by the end of this year, 2022, with the values finalized in 2023.
So with the EPA taking a much more active role on PFAS, water providers are obviously under the microscope. What advice do you have for utilities when it comes to public outreach and public communication?
It's a great question. And I would say that, you know, the best thing that we can be right now is proactive, right, as opposed to reactive, especially in light of these revised health advisory levels. They are much, much lower, below, you know, the current kind of standard commercial analytical detection limits. And so, you know, communicating with the public about how we are aware of PFAS, how we are responding to PFAS, and the various tools that we've adopted so far, I think is a great way to kind of, you know, bring the community along for the journey. And one other thing that I would say that is worth kind of remembering is the distinction between the general public and individuals that might live near a contaminated site or have occupational exposures, right? These are different situations than we're kind of seeing for the general public. And so I think when we do communicate with the public, we need to tailor our materials to be protective and specific to that community and address the concerns that they might have on a, you know, city by city basis.
And complicating all of this is that PFAS is everywhere, right? It's literally falling from the sky in rainwater.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And a lot of this is stemming from the fact that these PFAS chemicals are so persistent in the environment. They don't break down under most natural processes. And so therefore, all the PFAS that has been introduced into the environment over the last, you know, several decades just continues to move around the world. And so we do see PFAS have been detected in rainwater, surface soils, away from areas of known impact or contamination. And we see these concentrations in these kind of anthropogenic ambient background conditions higher than, for example, the health advisory drinking water levels. So certainly this is a challenge as we proceed towards developing a maximum contaminant level, an MCL for these chemicals. We need to be aware of the fact that these chemicals are quite literally falling from the sky at concentrations that exceed these kind of health-based values and account for that in our treatment technologies and our approach to delivering clean drinking water to communities.
Heather, amazing insights as always. I really appreciate it. Thank you for being here with me today.
Thanks so much, Andrew. It's a pleasure.
If you enjoyed this discussion and you want to see more conversations with the brightest minds in the environment and infrastructure, please like and subscribe for more. PFAS regulations are complicated and they vary widely from state to state. To help you understand what regulations affect your state, CDM Smith has put together an interactive map with the latest details. To check it out, click the link below or head to cdmsmith.com/PFAS.